Item number, SCP-383. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. All samples of SCP-383 must be kept in standard airtight plastic containers, frozen into ice blocks, and stored in a locker kept at -5°C at all times. All samples of SCP-383 removed for testing must be handled with a minimum safety equipment of a face mask, latex gloves, and protective goggles. Optional if personnel already wear prescription glasses. Personnel are reminded to wash hands after handling SCP-383-related materials. All suspected and confirmed infections of SCP-383 will be treated with personnel, and anyone they have had direct contact within the frame of infection, placed into quarantine for the duration of testing. A confirmed case of SCP-383 will result in personnel being placed under a week-long quarantine, and placed on antivirals until testing reveals that SCP-383 is fully flushed from the system. Infected civilians are to be treated similarly, and given a Class B amnestic, and told that they are in quarantine for a highly virulent new strain of the flu, and the cause of the outbreak must be identified. All objects created by SCP-383 must be cataloged, along with the current state of the host. Hosts of SCP-383 will be given a high-nutrition IV drip, and unless Class D testing is in operation, hosts will be kept mildly sedated and in safe, hospitable situations. For obvious security reasons, SCP-383 may not be introduced to any other SCPs. Description: SCP-383 is a viral infection, first categorized as a variant of influenza. The initial symptoms of SCP-383 are similar to those of the common cold, ranging through a variety of aches and pains, sinus issues, sore throat, upset stomach, coughing and sneezing, and fatigue. It appears to only be capable of infecting human hosts, but has been observed to be carried by other animals, such as rats and pigeons. Similar to a common infection, SCP-383 will work its way through the human body naturally within a few days, or faster with routine antivirals. However, SCP-383 is also accompanied by extreme waves of nausea. Along with bringing up the contents of the host's stomach, SCP-383 appears to be capable of, through unknown means, producing random items. These items are always sized appropriately to the host's mouth, even if it appears infeasible for them to originate from the stomach, suggesting that these items are actually produced either in the mouth or throat. More often than not, these items are useful, individually, to the host. For example, a host inside of a locked room may regurgitate a key, or a lockpick set, or a crowbar to pry the door open. While the results are far from consistent, the only pattern shown is that SCP-383 always produces items of use to the host in one way or another. SCP-383 has even been observed to create living animals and complex mechanical devices. Although SCP-383 would seem to have great potential as a Foundation asset, it should be noted that these items do not spontaneously appear. Rather, they are created from biomass from the human body. Victims are prone to anemia, nutrition loss, bone damage, and severe weight loss depending upon the fashion of items produced. Items that contain substances not found often inside the human body are often replaced with similar substances or missing non-vital parts. Infections can also cause damage to the mouth and esophagus and a weakening of the immune system. Hosts have also been observed to have a risk of choking on any items produced from SCP-383. Hosts of SCP-383 also report some difficulty swallowing foods, and the relatively consistent nausea makes it difficult to consume or digest any foods or liquids, occasionally resulting in dehydration. Due to SCP-383's highly virulent nature, occasional mutations can occur, resulting in SCP-383 strains that cause the host to regurgitate unsafe items, or substances such as boiling hot liquids or knives that injure or kill the host. Other somewhat common SCP-383 strains include a similar effect to the parent virus, but manifesting its item creation abilities through fecal excretion instead. Extra risk may be taken to prevent further strains of SCP-383 from developing, as a strain capable of infecting non-human entities, or with an entirely fatal reaction, could prove disastrous. Outbreaks of SCP-383 outside the SCP facility have been observed and contained. See addendum for details. Addendum: awaiting declassification. Item number: SCP-371. Object class: Euclid. Special containment procedures: all specimens of SCP-371 are to be contained in ocean water tanks, filled with at least 750 liters of water, approximately 200 gallon, per specimen, at between 2 and 5 degrees Celsius. Walls may be constructed of any waterproof metal or plate glass, and at least 2 inches thick. Once every 30 days, a live animal weighing between 25 and 45 kilograms, preferably oceanic fish, although in emergencies, any terrestrial vertebrate, including humans, with the head kept suspended above water will suffice, is to be deposited in the containment unit. Following the completion of the lytic cycle after 10 days, several SCP-371 specimens may be maintained, and all extra are to be strained out of the excurrent water, dried, and incinerated. Any personnel entering SCP-371's containment chamber intentionally must be equipped with scuba gear, commercially available shark-proof diving armor, thick faceplates, and Kevlar helmets. If these measures fail or are breached for any reason, the animal supply for that month may be skipped. There are currently 15 SCP-371 specimens in containment. Description: SCP-371 is a macroscopic marine virus, similar in appearance to a bacteriophage. SCP-371 specimens range in size from between 20 centimeters to 2.5 meters, are somewhat transparent, and can be mistaken for jellyfish in water. SCP-371's physiology and behavior appear similar to ordinary microscopic viruses, although with several adaptations that make it a notable marine predator. The contractile tail fibers, shown in Image A, are composed of stiffened proteins and are adapted for locomotion, swimming, grasping, walking on the ocean floor. A sharpened and hardened beak-like base plate, rendering the virus capable of injecting genetic material through the dermal skin of multicellular prey, and presumably unknown sensory organs. SCP-371 cannot see or hear, but appears to hunt by sensing heat, vibrations, and pressure and salinity gradients. Most notable is SCP-371's encoding mechanism, which does not use the direct injection of DNA or RNA, but rather numerous microscopic DNA encoding packets, which enter host cells and use them to respawn the macroscopic organism inside the host. Stages of SCP-371 infection: 0 hours, infection. SCP-371 pierces host's skin and injects genetic material into the host, usually into the cranial or abdominal cavity, causing significant pain. 8 hours, transcription, bonding. SCP-371 genetic packets begin normal transcription and translation process, bonding with host RNA. 95 hours, synthesis, spawning. As host cells replicate, they begin to encode extracellular proteins in the abdominal cavity, which form new SCP-371 specimens over time, between 10 and 100, depending on host size. Specimen size also changes with host size. 240 hours, lysis, bursting. Once specimens have reached 20 centimeters in size, they exit the host body in a modified bursting pattern, causing severe trauma to the host, and often resulting in serious bleeding, internal injuries, and death. SCP-371 lyses only in water, and for terrestrial prey, will postpone this stage until the host enters water again. For the rest of its life cycle, SCP-371 hunts, and apparently filters salts and sediments from ocean water in order to grow up to 2.5 meters in size. The virus's average life cycle is 60 days, although the oldest contained specimen is currently 109 days old. Addendum 371A. The initial SCP-371 specimens were found in the area of the Caribbean Sea, following the death of who was attacked when diving with a partner, who managed to capture film of three SCP-371 specimens clinging onto him, two on the head, one on the chest. The specimens lysed 10 days later when Mr. was taking a bath. Foundation-prepared explorational vehicles discovered and contained the initial specimens. Recently, a civilian research expedition to the Guaymas Basin Trench brought up footage of more specimens, and it is theorized that SCP-371 is native to hadal areas of the ocean floor, including vent areas, surfacing when prey becomes scarce. Item number, SCP-353. Object class, Keter. Special containment procedures. Biological hazard protocol is to be maintained at all times. Biohazard threat level 4. Full hazardous material suits, gloves, and oxygen supply will be required to examine subject. A disinfectant shower and decontamination spray are standard procedure before and after contact with SCP-353. The whole containment unit is to be kept underground, at negative pressure, and hermetically sealed at all times to prevent accidental contamination to the outside area. In the case of containment breach, all affected personnel are to be placed in immediate biohazard level 4 quarantine. Termination will be required in the possibility of an outbreak of one or more class 9 infectious agents. Subjects should be fed 3 times a day, as standard, and provided with the minimum required comfort items: a twin-size bed, a pillow, and a blanket. Clothing in the form of disposable surgical scrubs are to be provided as needed, but requests for items should otherwise be denied. Any outward signs of disease in the subject, such as rashes, boils, vomiting, or sickly pallor or demeanor, should be reported with haste, since the appearance of symptoms in SCP-353 means a willful effort on her part. Subject is to be subdued and questioned. Should SCP-353 need to leave its containment facility for any reason, it is to be fitted with an explosive collar, time-release drug delivery service for dosages of euphoric substances, and biohazard containment suit. Should SCP-353's suit breach containment, emergency sterilization procedures, up to and including incineration of the affected area, are to be carried out. Description. SCP-353 appears to be a normal human female, 26 years old, of average physical capacity and average intelligence. Subject has the capacity to siphon infectious viral and bacterial agents from her environment, nurture and store them within her body, and then redistribute them to devastating pandemic effect. SCP-353's mood directly affects the radius of infections recorded, with increased emotional states leading to massively increased potency. SCP-353 seems to be immune from the symptoms of said infectious agents, but just as long as she is only passively storing them, her active, willful attempts to nurture, manipulate, and change infectious agents while they remain in her body cause her to manifest symptoms ranging from mildly annoying to severe. Symptoms only last as long as she is actively inducing a change in the quantity or quality of an infectious agent, and thus rarely last longer than a few hours. Examinations have shown that the subject is able to store almost any infectious bacterial or viral agents within her body, though she is only capable of changing agents that are able to naturally survive within the human body. As of writing this report, SCP-353's blood contains traces of over 1,000 different infectious agents, including human immunodeficiency virus, or HIV, Ebola, Marburg, 67 different strains of the common cold, herpes simplex A, E. coli, cholera, bubonic plague, SARS, and malaria. At least 30% of said infectious agents were previously unknown to the medical community, and were possibly engineered by SCP-353 herself, making SCP-353 an invaluable resource. Addendum 3531. SCP-353 was originally encountered and data expunged, South Africa, where she seemed to be deliberately seeking to pick up strains of the Ebola virus. Foundation personnel pursued SCP-353 to Dresden, Germany, where they determined that she had successfully contracted Marburg and redistributed said virus to data expunged. Subject was eventually subdued by physical means and taken into Foundation custody with minimal loss of life. To date, her true identity is unknown, as she gives no name other than Vector and refuses to answer any questions about her past. SCP-353 claims to have traveled the Western world seeking greater infections for her collection. When asked why, she would not give a response aside from, "Because I can." Addendum 3532. Initial testing has shown that she is as adept at manipulating and changing infectious agents in the bodies of nearby subjects as she is at manipulating them within her own body. She seems to prefer to manipulate diseases within her own body, however, as it grants her full access to the results of her manipulations. Furthermore, her ability to manipulate disease in nearby subjects means it's likely that she is equally capable of curing diseases and dispensing them. On a different note, personnel are reminded to refer to humanoid SCPs by their numerical SCP designation. Should SCP-353 refuse to cooperate, she is to be subdued and punished. We're not here to make her X-Men villain fantasies come true. Dr. Sarah Jarvie. Addendum 3533. Given that this girl is a walking time bomb of viruses, I recommend that we trank her, strap her to a table, and give her a massive dose of ribavirin interferon cocktail to flush her system. Dr. Addendum 3534. Flush her system? Hell no! Did you know that this girl somehow has the original strain of the 1918 Spanish flu, as well as a half dozen strains of viruses we've never seen? The research possibilities alone. Dr. Addendum 3535. Limited research approved. 05. Addendum 3536. The embrace of this Vector persona, including the fixation on the color black for cosmetic purposes, her might makes right attitude, her desire to infect rather than to cure, and her disregard for human life all signal towards extreme malignant narcissism and psychopathic tendencies. Her obvious pleasure in manipulating and controlling diseases within herself, despite the often painful symptoms involved, are also quite troubling. Requesting approval for psychological examination, counseling or therapy may be useful in reducing her difficult demeanor. Dr. Glass. Item number SCP-340. Object class: safe. Special containment procedures: SCP-341, 3, 4, and 5 are to be communally housed in a 10 meter by 10 meter by 2.5 meter tank, with the water temperature maintained between 25 degrees Celsius and 30 degrees Celsius. Antidepressants and broad-spectrum antibiotics are to be administered intravenously every 12 hours. Medicinal compounds may not be added to the standard nutritive paste without approval. All waste products must be properly sterilized. Any personnel who aspirate water from the containment tank must report to medical staff immediately. Description: SCP-340 is produced by a human-specific virus, which preferentially colonizes the nasal cavities. The virus cannot be identified according to the Baltimore classification scheme, leading Foundation researchers to believe it was engineered by parties as yet unidentified. The presence of genes from both HIV and the SARS coronavirus supports this hypothesis. An incubation period, with a mean duration of 3 days, occurs upon initial exposure to the virus. Influenza-like symptoms will then develop, and will persist for a mean of 7 days before clearing up. An increased production of mucus has been observed in all known cases, and will persist after other symptoms have ceased. Virulence is highest during the first 5 days of infection, but viral particles have been detected up to a month after exposure in Foundation trials. Any time after infection, a high blood concentration of carbon dioxide will trigger production of SCP-340. When initially produced, SCP-340 is a jelly-like mucus, which extrudes to cover the lower half of the face, including the nose and mouth. SCP-340 in mucus form will undergo a catalytic reaction when immersed in water, and will set into a bioplastic membrane. The chemical composition of the bioplastic facilitates the data expunged process. Although it causes SCP-340 to degrade, the process allows the host to breathe underwater. The membrane is flexible and does not inhibit the host's facial movement. Any tears or holes which develop due to mechanical stress or SCP-340 degradation will be regenerated within 30 seconds due to constant production of SCP-340. Virulence is drastically reduced in this stage, but viral particles have been detected in water samples contaminated with SCP-340. Environmental contact may still spread the infection. When SCP-340 is exposed to air, it dries into a chitinous substance, similar to crustacean shells. The water vapor trapped inside an SCP-340 sealed respiratory system is sufficient to prevent premature hardening. The hardening process also destroys its ability to data expunged, and loss of function is irreversible after approximately 2 minutes exposure to air. Once fully hardened, SCP-340 is impossible to remove without inflicting major tissue damage. It is harder than any generally known organic substance. A standard tungsten carbide drill bit required more than 15 minutes of constant use to drill a hole through 5 millimeters of dried SCP-340. Research is ongoing into methods for the in vitro culture and harvest of SCP-340 for use in industrial applications. Addendum 341. Circumstances of retrieval. On date undisclosed, 12 students at a boarding school in United States began to produce SCP-340 during a swimming competition. 9 died before a Foundation containment team could be dispatched to the site. 5 suffocated when attempts to clear airways of hardened SCP-340 failed. 2 suffocated after attempts to open alternate airways induced hardening of air-exposed SCP-340 in the trachea, and 2 died from dehydration. Upon arrival, the Foundation containment team quarantined the school until the infection spread could be determined. 4 additional cases were discovered who were not yet producing SCP-340. All 7 were taken into Foundation custody. The team then distributed Class A amnestics and followed cover-up procedure Gimmel 2, the tragic fire scenario. Addendum 342. SCP-340 doesn't kill the host's oral bacteria, and the antibiotics can't stave off infection forever. Surgical removal of the host's teeth will be safer in the long run than trying to deal with abscesses, bone infection, and sepsis. Do we have a laparoscopic surgeon on staff? Dr. Cairns. Document 341. Inventory. SCP-341 through 7. SCP-341. Caucasian male. Age at retrieval, 12. SCP-340 production at retrieval, positive. Notes. Housed at site. SCP-342. African American male. Age at retrieval, 12. SCP-340 production at retrieval, positive. Notes. Deceased. Complications from surgical insertion of feeding tube. SCP-343. Caucasian male. Age at retrieval, 11. SCP-340 production at retrieval, positive. Notes. Housed at site. SCP-344. Hispanic male. Age at retrieval, 12. SCP-340 production at retrieval, negative. Notes. Underwent experimental treatment. Treatment failed. SCP-340 production induced. Housed at site. SCP-345. Caucasian male. Age at retrieval. 27. SCP-340 production at retrieval. Negative. Notes. Refused experimental treatment. Voluntarily induced SCP-340 production. Housed at site. SCP-346. Caucasian male. Age at retrieval. 12. SCP-340 production at retrieval. Negative. Notes. Underwent experimental treatment. Treatment failed. SCP-340 production induced. Deceased. Voluntary self-termination. SCP-347. Caucasian male. Age at retrieval. 13. SCP-340 production at retrieval. Negative. Notes. Underwent experimental treatment. Treatment initially believed successful. Deceased. Suffocation due to unexpected SCP-340 production. Item number. SCP-217. Object class. Keter. Special containment procedures. Containment area is to be kept behind two reverse pressure airlocks. Chemical shower sterilization. Full contained atmosphere hazmat suits and 24-hour post-interaction quarantine and testing are mandatory for all personnel entering containment area. Should containment be breached, the blast door for the containment and research area will seal, and Chemical Agent ZEER-21711 will be pumped into the air. Any humans exposed to SCP-217 are to be contained and held for observation. Any items touched by those affected by SCP-217 must be sterilized. Description. SCP-217 is a virus, incurable by current means, with a rate of infectivity at 100%. It affects all organisms in the kingdom Anomalia, and can be spread via touch or contact with bodily fluid. SCP-217 is very hardy, and can survive for years outside the host body. The process of the infection is very slow, with some subjects going several years before manifesting any symptoms. SCP-217 alters the biochemistry of organic tissue, causing organic matter to rearrange into a form of organic metal. The processes involved with this change are not yet fully understood, but the advanced stages are well documented. A subject will begin to turn into a complex arrangement of gears and clockwork, these taking over for the former biological functions. Advanced stage infection is reported to be very painful, but earlier stages are oftentimes unnoticed, with only vague feelings of confusion, insomnia, and joint stiffness. Hearts are replaced by gears and small tubes, joints by gear networks, eyes by structures not unlike primitive hand crank film cameras, etc. SCP-217 shows first on the outside of the body in all creatures, except mammals. In mammals, it first converts the internal structure, before manifesting outside the body. This can cause those infected to go for very long periods of time without knowing of infection. SCP-217 has even been shown to totally convert the inside of the body before showing any externally visible symptoms. SCP-217 has infected several major metropolitan areas in the past, most notably. The mental state of those in middle to advanced stages of infection has been shown to be much diminished. Subjects respond in a repetitive fashion, are very dull and mechanical in action, are easily distracted and confused, and appear generally irritable when faced with new problems. In addition, research on a fully converted brain has data expunged. Document number 217-6. Notes on symptoms. Subjects infected by SCP-217 have, at early stages, reported no major symptoms, aside from increased lethargy and a general lack of emotional response. Some have reported a feeling of fluttering or moving under the skin, coupled with a persistent ticking noise. This noise seems most prominent when SCP-217 infects the shoulders, neck, and head. However, it is inaudible if recording equipment is pressed against an affected area. Initial infection of SCP-217 is, as has already been stated, almost undetectable. As the infection advances, subjects will begin to feel sharp, tearing pain in areas that are being converted. It has been compared to a knife wound or a deep muscle tear. It can persist for hours or several days, depending on both the subject and the area affected. The new clockwork organs appear to tear and rip at tissue for a short time, before becoming fully integrated and settling into the surrounding tissue, and this is believed to account for the pain. Areas infected appear to be metal, mainly brass, steel, and iron. Other substances have been reported, appearing to be leather, rubber, glass, wood, and other basic materials. Despite appearances, it is purely organic material and even carries the subject's DNA. Organs and tissues affected appear more resilient than normal, carrying the same strength and density as the materials they resemble, instead of normal tissue density. Areas damaged repair over time, but it is much slower than standard human regeneration. Damaged areas can be instantly repaired by replacing damaged areas with new parts of the same type. Testing has shown that there are no ill effects if parts made from normal materials, steel, wood, leather, replace the existing biomechanical clockworks. Most alarming, people infected with SCP-217 can continue for months, even years, without being detected. With infection so easy to spread, hundreds could be affected before proper containment could be enforced. Infection appears to spread most quickly in large offices, malls, and other large concentrations of people. Note: anything or anyone suspected or confirmed to be infected with SCP-217 is not to be allowed near SCP-882. Addendum: at this time, cross-experimentation between SCP-229 and SCP-217 is allowed, only with O5 approval. Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now, and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.